want you to, so just go ahead and take them with your student staff ID to the circulation desk and take them home for a couple of weeks. Good reading on the spring break. So we have just finished our lineup for spring quarter, so if you'd like a copy of next quarter's schedule, that's right here. Feel free to take one. If we run out, I can get you another. And if you are passionate about an idea, we want to hear about it. We love having students, staff, faculty, and community members come and facilitate these sessions. So feel free to talk to either myself or Kelly McHenry. Kelly, raise your hand if you'd like to be on the schedule for fall. So at the end of this discussion, I'm going to ask you to fill out a short survey. It's 5 questions. It's all just checking boxes to see what we can do with this session to make it better, what you liked, what you didn't like, etc. This is for you. We want to know what you all want to see. So, since there is no session next week, please join me in welcoming Owen Salveson for our final COSI as he discusses Justice for Sale, how the for-profit prison system is bankrupting society. Owen.
Thank you guys for coming. Good to see a decent turnout here. So, kind of start this off by, how many of you know, how many of you are aware of what a private prison is?
Say that again.
What a privatized prison system is, like what that entails. Private prisons are basically for-profit institutions. They are both newly built and former government institutions that have been sold to private institutions or corporations to turn a profit. There's a lot of inherent conflict of interests involved in a process like this that undermine our justice system in a lot of different ways. I guess the question is, do profit motives have a place anywhere in our justice system? This is kind of this, like the fiscal year of 2010, the average was $85.72 per day per prisoner, which is kind of what these corporations look at as their potential profits, which is really an interesting perspective to take on what we're talking about here, which is really putting people in cages and taking away their freedom.
Is that across the country? Is that just Washington State, that figure?
I believe this is national. It's from the Bear Institute. I think that was kind of an average across the board. If anybody had any questions throughout this, feel free to raise your hands. This is a public discussion, so I try to facilitate any discussion with all of us so we can kind of come to a better understanding about this. I'm really just trying to get this information out there and kind of like what I've come to understand, because I really feel like the more people understand this, the less that it's going to be okay for media and governments to kind of like pull the wool over our eyes and distract us, essentially, or distract us from the real issues, which is really, I mean, I guess I feel like this is actually the root cause of a lot of what's going on in our society right now. This facilitates racial segregation, racial subjugation, as well as, since the, with the rise of the civil rights movement, the ability to, I guess that the ability to subjugate groups of people is kind of diversified, and, I come from a relatively poor area that hasn't really had crime rate, and I see a lot of the things, like, You know, I've been to a few protests here that kind of focused on issues where the people organizing it, and it's usually like the Ferguson debacle. I go to these protests, and people there, and I understand, they want to, you know, it's about black people, and it's about, you know, the police, but it's more than that. It's, you know, I come from this small town, so I've seen a lot of this, and I've seen groups of people being separated from the rest of society and criminalized just kind of for who they are and where they come from. So, I mean, I feel like a part of this when I go to these kind of, protests. And, you know, it's, I guess I see an overarching theme that is more inclusive, that kind of points to more of what the root of all of the current issues are, in terms of policy or whatnot. So, for-profit justice systems have kind of diversified over time. I mean, this all kind of started back around 40 years ago. And, I mean, while some may not, I might ask, how many people feel that they have been affected by somebody incarcerated or kind of incarcerated or prison institution, jail institution? Okay. It's quite a few of you. I mean, I think that a lot of people out there kind of, choose to believe because of their economic status or because of their social networks that this doesn't really affect them. But this affects our laws, this affects our justice system, and it affects our communities. So while some people may think that there's several degrees of separation between them and any of these effects, I think if they understood a little bit more about the scope of all of this, it really does affect everybody.
Well, I would just comment, I mean, if we pay taxes, this is what we're paying for, and to have so many people in prison who aren't able to lead productive lives and help their families hurts all of us in society.
Well, I mean, what this amounts to is it's somewhat of a caste system. What we're doing, when somebody's been in prison, they are essentially a second-class citizen for the rest of their lives in this country. They oftentimes can't vote, they're going to have a hard time getting renting a house, renting an apartment, getting loans.
Getting a job,
yeah, especially. And these things stick with you. So once you have these kinds of convictions, this is something that's really difficult to get away from. And it affects the whole community. So here I just kind of have a list of the different kinds of justice systems that have kind of, I guess you'd say they've been sold off to the highest bidder. I mean, a little bit has to do with political ties and things of that nature. Basically, like these politicians that be a bunch of these CEOs, they have a lot of time to discuss about these things, build friendships. We have the private prison system. I mean, it's kind of the main focus of this. That's really the biggest component of this, I believe. But it also, it's gone into, I'm sure you guys are familiar with the photo traffic enforcement things that are really interesting. Are you all familiar with those? And there are cameras set up around town, a lot of them are red light cameras, some of them are speeding cameras. And these are actually promoted by these companies that are part of the prison industrial complex, which is the bigger group of companies involved in profiting from all of this. These companies, so how many of you have had a ticket from one of those photo enforcement? Okay, so I was really interested to find out that 50% of those tickets, 50% of that price that you pay, goes directly to the company that provides and maintains that equipment. which is insane. And if any of you are wondering how to take care of it, if you actually just give a call up on the phone and complain and just kind of tell them how you don't think it was a legitimate thing, because it's a, because you're taking from their bottom line at that point, they'll oftentimes just dismiss it.
They actually choose we said that you wanted to drive them, they just dismiss it.
Yes, my brother Collinger did that for me once. On the other end of this, we also have the probation services, which have been sold off to these for-profit businesses, and just throwing that profit motive in the loop here. I mean, no matter how much you want, even if you really want, there not to be a conflict of interest, I don't really see from merely a logical perspective how that's even possible. So, once you get out of these prisons, a lot of people are thrown into hands. I know North Dakota, I believe, and Montana have these private probation companies. So these people have a vested interest in maintaining control of them. So, I'll take a step back here. I get quite a bit of time here. Really to kind of understand this, I feel like it's helpful to go back into a little bit of history here and to kind of understand how all this is kind of come to be. While slavery was mostly abolished in 1864, right after the Civil War, it wasn't a unanimous decision to have a war over it. I'm not sure that tons and tons of people died. It was almost tore the entire country apart. Now, we basically forced a lot of the South to accept this. And a stipulation was actually written into the amendment that abolished slavery, that still allowed for forced labor, but now only for, as like a punishment for a crime. So, this actually, this allowed for plantation owners to not actually have to close down their plantations, because private companies were allowed to contract labor. It's kind of like how one might contract, a mule out to do farm work, essentially. And now it just did. Oh, yes.
I was wondering if you could repeat that again. The one you said before before you started talking about the farming part. You were talking about a definition about the slavery part.
It was the amendment that abolished slavery in this country.
Okay, yeah.
It contained a stipulation that still allowed for forced labor but now only for punishment or as punishment for a crime. In some ways they justify this this is like twofold. They justify this because they feel that the prisoners should pay their own way, which kind of it should be a public service, really what this is. And it helps reform. And on some ways, done in some particular ways, that can be true. Because a lot of people that end up in prisons don't have a lot of work history and don't have skills. So what we ended up with, and a lot of people aren't aware of this, what we ended up with after this was, the plantations weren't actually forced to close. They just, changed what it kind of changed the guise under which they were working. This continued on for until the 1920s, where people were allowed to, companies or individuals were allowed to contract out to hire people that were criminalized. This is actually done by changing the definition of crime, which has been done several times in the last century, this is done several times over. And by changing the definition, the word crime, what we've done is included more people as criminals. We've criminalized a group of people, essentially. Kind of a cyclic thing that happens fairly often in the country, and it's oftentimes not talked about and kind of, especially in the media, swept under the carpet. So, and this practice of contracting out to private individuals, to private entities, actually ended in around 1920, mostly in 1920, and finally by about 1930. And the reason behind this,
So how were the proceeds split between the labor contractor and the state prison business?
You know, back then, I'm not exactly sure. So one of the reasons, and I'll talk about that in a moment too, is kind of collusion between, or like backdoor agreements between these high-level prison officials and the contractors. This is a common thing in politics, and probably politics in general, where companies, especially in this country, companies and corporations are, you know, they call it a revolving door between political spots, political seats, and CEO with large, high corporate spots, jobs. So they abolished this pretty much by about 1930. And they did this, the reasons that they cited for doing this was basically like public outcry. For terrible treatment of workers. This one down in the corner, I think, is from, it's from Arizona, somewhere in the US. Competition of forced labor with the free workforce was another reason that they did this back in 1920. It's American Apparel laying off 150 workers because of direct competition with the captive workforce.
For which the numbers of that workforce get paid like 37 cents an hour.
It varies depending on the
job.
Yeah, it's as low as 10 cents an hour, actually.
Yeah, when I was in, it was 17 cents was the lowest Washington State does.
What? Oh, you're in a state?
Yeah.
Depends on the particular institution, state or federal.
And if you get a CLI job or not.
Yeah, that's a specialized, like,
the correctional industry, so it's one of those private organizations that contracts with states.
Okay. Yeah.
CI job, not CLI.
Speaking of...
So are these forced labor workforces still allowed to bid on government and state contracts?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, Unicor, I think that Unicor is a federal prison agency, I'm not sure what to call it, corporation, that does, the bulletproof vests in the country. They do a lot of the military contracting for uniforms and such. Speaking of private companies contracting for this labor, these are a few of, two of them are local, based locally. Companies that are actually contracting for using this captive workforce. Government actually sees this as a means to compete with countries like China and Asia in like sweatshop conditions, which is really interesting. I mean, we talk about the conditions in China, you hear it on the news all the time. People talking about the border conditions, the unlivable wages, and so on. And a lot of people don't understand, especially something that we're looking to facilitate through policy and this crazy system over the years, about 40 years since it's been reintroduced. This particular report that I found for these companies, 93 cents per hour to $4 per day. And considering that, sending a phone call in a prison, it can cost, it can cost easily $15 to $20 for a 10 everything you've been called.
Base rates, the last time I was in, was a year ago, was $3 to start the call, and then 10 cents a minute.
Okay, yeah. 10 cents a minute, that's a lot less than it was a few years ago.
Or, I never made any phone calls, I never had any money.
I mean, the people that we put in the prisons, and this is, I believe that the overarching theme of who's going in the prisons is really kind of defined by your socioeconomic status. And I believe this is represented by the absence of wealthy people in prisons of all types, of all races. I mean, they're not really in there. And it's because our system is unfairly set up for people that have them.
I have a question about those numbers. Is that the number that the prisoner gets paid? Is it the number that the company is paying?
This is what the prisoner gets paid.
Numbers. So how much are the companies paying?
I believe that's what the prisoner gets paid. And I'm not sure, but I know that the companies, I mean, they obviously choose this particular way of getting work done because it's cheap. It's done, you know,
but I'm sure they're paying the prison corporation more than that. Right?
I would assume that there's some, you know, some fee involved in this whole, the private prison companies are set up to make money, so any and every way they can, they save money and kind of make money.
So, do you think then they get a cut of what is paid to the prisoners on top of what the government is paying them to keep the prisoners?
Well, we give them an hourly wage.
The prisoner, at least here in Washington, gets the hourly wage. The state then takes 30% for cost of imprisonment, and then your legal financial obligations take a cut. If you owe any back child support, there's another cut. They can take between 60% and 105%. Of your earnings.
5%.
So that other figure you had of $83 point something a day for the cost of average cost in 2010 of keeping someone in a private prison is something paid by the government, I assume, and then on top
it's
of
paid,
that
yeah,
they get another 30% of the wages?
Of whatever the inmate makes, it goes back to the prison.
Uh-huh, uh-huh. I see. So maybe it's
cool. And that's just the way they handle it here in Washington in our state prisons. I don't know about county or federal.
As I understand it, the money that prisoners make generally goes back to, you know, to some one of these companies that make up the larger prison industrial complex. I mean, you're paying a phone company outrageous rates for your family because you stay connected. You're, you know, paying outrageous rates for everyday products that we pay, you know, a small fraction.
Candy bar is $1.50. Top ramen, get it at 10 cents at the store, costs $1 while you're in. And is the base that people use for trade. How much is that in a pack of soup? I'll give you five packs of soup for a phone call.
Yeah.
Is it a question of balance? So, because like, so I've interacted with, I mean, I used to go into the Washington State prisons and work with various groups, and I think there's a role probably for being able to make money and spend and have some sort of that going on, but it's a question of how little, because you have so little power, are being paid. I mean, so, is, and then, you know, I mean, I think we all agree that there's horrendous things going on, and this conflict of interest. But is there some role then for this sort of thing to be going on or not? You know, I mean, at any level.
What sort of thing? What are you
For someone who's in prison to be able to work, make some money, have, you know, choose some sort of thing in prison, you know?
I believe there are legitimate things. There are legitimate, you know, there is some legitimate grounding for that. It's particularly it's done. And the companies that are involved and the way they get these contracts is really successful.
Part of the issue is that these prisons are set up in kind of after the model of the old company stores around the 1900s that the miners used to have to deal with, so.
I'm just playing devil's advocate a little bit, to spice things up.
Sorry.
So, we have these interesting things that that people refer to as lockup quotas and they also call it low contact. So these private companies, these corporations, these prison corporations, will actually lobby or enter into legal agreements with the states or with governments to ensure a minimum amount of people, a minimum amount of beds filled. I believe the minimums range anywhere from 80 to 100%, which is,
If they're not filled,
the state is still paying.
Mm-hmm.
So what often happens is they export prisoners, or they import prisoners, rather. So I know, and this is particularly bad in Hawaii, they export two-thirds of their state prisoners to all over the country. And as I understand, a lot of the people in Hawaii, or a good percentage anyway, a fair percentage, actually no numbers, are, you know, locals, are the people that grew up there that are culturally from Hawaii. And when you take a person out, away from their support network, we see all kinds of horrible, really negative consequences to something like that. When you take somebody's support network away, rehabilitation fails more often. We have a huge, much, much higher recidivism rate. I mean, it's emotionally to the individual, it's you know, for some people, that's all you have. Yes?
I was wondering about that concept of low crime caps. Does it actually, in some states and some periods, end up costing the state more than if they own the prisons and the beds were empty whenever they would?
And that's one of the reasons, that's one of the benefits that's touted, that's kind of promoted by these private corporations, prison corporations, for reasoning to continue on with this, for, you know, to explain their own legitimacy in the system. And the way that they do that is actually, analysis of data is really a very subjective thing. And they're able to do it and, you know, tweak certain aspects of the analysis to make them look like they're really saving a lot of money, but independent analysis doesn't really show the same thing.
The other reason, to get back on track, the other reason is that back in the 1920s, and still, you know, back in 1920, 1930, other reasons were corruption and basically corruption for between prison officials and private companies for lucrative prison labor contracts. This is an example of what I mentioned earlier, the revolving door of sorts between elected officials and high-end positions in these prison companies in other parts of the prison industrial complex. And, you know, CCA is Corrections Corp of America. It's one of the two biggest private corrections companies in the world and in the United States. And we have two elected officials here that are now on the CCA's board of directors. I kind of doubt that they were actually on board of directors while they were in office. But the fact that they moved from this position to the other position is really, it's a sign of what's really going on here. And this happens on a lot of different other levels as well. I know it happened, the governor of Ohio actually appointed, I think it was either a CCA or a GEO Group CEO to a position within his, within his control, basically, an elected government position. So, what exactly do I mean when I say lucrative? These companies
companies make ridiculous amounts of money. I mean, it's hard to even grasp, like, what these numbers mean. I know that, to start off, I know that, in 2012, the Geo Group and CCA, they're the two biggest players in this game, I guess, pulled in $3.3 billion in revenue for 2012 alone. These two companies, they make up 75% of the industry. Yeah, 1,600% increase from 1990 to 2010. This has been going on for about 40 years. Actually, so there's been a little bit of kickback recently, politically and socially, because how many people here know how many people we have? We have to keep behind bars or freedom is good to know.
It's 2.5 million.
Yeah, it's right around there currently. Yeah.
Is that including the people in the immigration detention facilities as well?
Yeah, well, so what they've been doing with this kickback on putting American citizens in cages, incarcerated, they've been shifting, these companies have been shifting, using that, you know, the insane amounts of money that they have to influence our political system. Our political system, unfortunately, in many ways resembles a legalized system of bribes. I mean, we pay lobbyists, these guys take that money from us, pay lobbyists, and use it to, I mean, they use it how any other corporation would. They use it to protect their interests and to promote their interests. Their particular interests just happen to be putting people in cages. So they actually view any bill, any legislature that aims to mitigate our prison populations as a threat. And I've read some of these companies, like, shareholder reports, and they actually say things like that. I mean, it's insane, like, reading these things and just being able to conceptualize humans' lives, like, individual, like, communities, lives of communities and families, and, like, as a commodity. So, back to the redefinition of crime. We've done this, you know, a number of times. Kind of wish this went back to the 1920s and 30s because there were some other changes around there. But done this a number of times throughout the course of the last 100 years. And another thing we've done is, well, starting at about. Starting about 1971 here, we have the war on drugs with Nixon and criminalizing a group of population that in the past has kind of been seen as ill, and treatment was kind of seen as the preferable way to kind of try to help these people. So, right around 1955, psychotropic drugs were introduced, and this, this actually started, you know, this is about the time when we had a lot of people in mental institutions, but there was money going towards this, so, you know, maybe it wasn't done in a very productive or helpful manner. The whole system at that point was pretty archaic. But tectonic coast. And around 1980 here, Reagan took, well, they made the whole industry, the whole mental asylum, this is what they called them back then, made a directed effort to try to reduce populations. With the introduction of these drugs, a lot of these people were actually able to be reintroduced to society. A lot of these things actually help people. But some of these drugs are also addictive. I mean, what we're doing is we're playing with people's neurology in a way that we don't really understand. I mean, to this day, we really don't understand how most psychotropic is. The mechanisms are just unknown. So I've kind of considered that. And the rise of addiction around that time, there's definitely a correlation. And the criminalization of mentally ill, of addicted individuals, of homeless, around this time we see a huge spike in different populations. Kind of an overview of the two top business corporations. I guess we just have 66 prisons by CCA, 65 by Geo Group, holding 91,000 and 65,000 and 66,000 respectively. So yeah, in the 80s, a big wave of regulation for better or for worse, selling off these companies. It's kind of how this all kind of got started.
Well, isn't this also when they started closing down the psychiatric facilities
in some of these late 80s?
Just turning people out to their whatever they could find?
Yeah. And then, you know, they're out in society, and because they're out in society,
they're not getting treatment.
They're doing things that are disruptive, and doing a lot of things that maybe at one time have been seen as something that needed help rather than locking people up. These are the main criticisms of the system. I mean, I feel like they're all pretty valid. I'll go over them in a second. The lack of transparency is a particularly interesting one in the incentivization of incarceration. I mean, it really does put a direct, Louisiana is a pretty good, an interesting case study in all of this. They have a system that is essentially unchecked in terms of, so a lot of private prisons down there, a lot of the entrepreneurs behind the system are actually sheriffs at the side of the areas that they, where the prisons operate. So they have a really direct incentive to put people in these prison beds. They have the highest prison population in the entire world, Louisiana. I think it's three times that of Iran.
Per capita, yeah.
Per capita, yeah. Less civil savings, I'm just gonna go over that in a moment. Fewer services, which in turn leads to higher recidivism rates and less treatment. And poorly trained staff, they have a much higher turnover rate at these places. So the staff that are actually working in these places don't really know what they're doing. There's a lot more fights and a lot more injuries to inmates. Yes?
I'm from a small town. In the town I'm from, there's a juvenile prison, two state prisons.
What's the population of that town?
6,000. They not be,
there's motivation in putting prisons in small towns. Mm-hmm. It raises the population level and decreases the number of available voting population. And so it's a way that politicians will use to control getting reelected. It's oftentimes done in red counties, is they'll bring in a prison so that they can increase the voting population, and particularly in rural areas.
Yeah, it's actually, this is a way that they actually promote this to the government, saying we're gonna make your economy better, we're gonna provide you with jobs and really they're just taking what this really amounts to is we're tearing apart families, we're tearing apart community, with putting lots of non-violent people in business, what we're doing is really taking people out of society that would otherwise be productive members of society. You know, in so many cases, the glue kind of holds things together. And when you take people out of these situations, communities fall apart. This is actually, it's like kind of a perpetuating cycle of crime and poverty.
And you said before that the idea of having people work is so that they have a work history. Like, can they even use that work history if and when they get out of prison? Can they say, well, you know, I did this while I was in prison, doesn't even matter? Would people even hire them based on that?
Some places do. I mean, there are places that, I believe there are places that specifically, you know, kind of cater to hiring people from what you're coming back from.
There are, and it also provides some training, like you get hazardous material training within your first week of arriving at a Washington State prison, and then the janitorial training is one of the, or industrial sanitization training is one of the core classes that they teach at the colleges there, and there's college training, college classes you can take while inside also. So
but no
there is,
computers.
Huh?
But no computers.
Oh, there are computers.
That for the prisoners to use?
Not in this. Well, they have what they call JK, which is another private company that contracts with the state to give communication between family members and stuff. So those computers you can use, and then inside the classrooms, there's computers you can use for the couple hours a day that you might be in the classroom.
Oh, because I wanted to go teach library skills, you know, at a prison, and I was told that prisoners couldn't have computers, and really hard to without
well, no,
having
no
like
internet.
An adequate library.
Yeah. There's
no
internet, but there
okay.
are computers.
Okay, no internet, yeah.
So maybe that's what they meant.
So yeah, and almost all of our library resources are on internet-based
mm-hmm.
databases.
Yeah, like while I was in, I took classes on Microsoft stuff, the equivalent to MIC 101 here at this school.
Okay.
So there are classes you can take, and training. Almost everybody leaves with at least basic janitorial experience.
There were a couple points you made earlier. Like, I would just like to take one touch on it.
Yeah.
Because you had spoken about how many inmates are currently locked up in the prison system. However, you had also mentioned this recidivism, which is criminals returning to the prison system. The way back to prison is basically through parole and probation. That way, there's sort of a barrier between, you know, civilization and prison. You have that little buffer. So probation, parole, a lot of people are on it. Actually, there's about 4.5 million people who are on probation and parole in the United States right now. Those people, about one-third of those people, will recidivate. They will return back to prison because they haven't learned the skills to be able to cope with the psychological issues that they have been struggling with for their life. Education is wonderful in prison, but it's psychological first aid that we need to focus on. In my opinion, we have a group of people who keep returning to prison for a reason. What is that reason? Money? Sure. But the reason why we started locking up people, you would have also touched on this, the deinstitutionalization period in the United States, that was in the 1955 to 1965, there was a huge movement to shut down mental institutions, mostly due to like books like One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, that shed light on the mistreatment of mentally ill in mental institutions. So they had begun to shut down mental institutions. Now you have no barrier, there's no buffer between mentally unstable people and more productive citizens
In the business?
No, in society. So the productive citizens who didn't know how to handle these people when they were released needed a resolution, so they started going to prison for violations, jaywalking, or indecent exposure, whatever it was. There were all of these minor infractions that people could be locked up for. Then in the 70s, there was an expansion of a narrow-minded philosophy in democracy, which was Republicans and Democrats anyways, what had happened was there was sort of, I'm sorry, I was really ranting here. Basically, the prison systems got filled up with mentally ill individuals, and then the war on drugs came about, and it became basically a war on people who had a different perspective, sort of a subculture in the American society at that point.
Well, I think, I don't know how many, I've grown up in this culture, and I think we lose perspective on what fair and right is in terms of punishment. I think it's valuable to ask, why do we lock people up? Why do we put people in prison? Like, a lot of people, assume that we put people in prison to make society safer, to help society. And I think that could be shown, that it does to an extent, and on certain levels, there is there's gonna be a decrease in crime with more punishment. But my chart, back in 1990, since 1990, our crime rate's been going down. So we passed that point of diminishing returns 20 years ago. This isn't really helping anything anymore. It's making things worse.
So underlying all the things that you were just talking about is this other thing that's going on in our country, which is institutionalized racism and racial profiling. And people who may have committed one crime, they're under focus for if they commit another crime, they get caught. We have these three strikes, you're outlawed. People who were arrested for smoking marijuana before it was legal, that could have been one of their three strikes. They go to these prisons, they get into that system, and lose skills, lose productivity, lose their connection socially, and come out, have a hard time because they're not connected. It's mentally difficult to be in prison, I'm sure. And
are you familiar with the organization Alex? Alec, the American Legislative Exchange Council. Anybody here?
But the other part of that I wanted to talk about was that for a long, long time, government has tried to privatize all their services. Rather than have the government actually provide them, you're seeing that here at Seattle Central. As students, you used to have most of your tuition was paid for by the state of Washington, if you're a local resident. And now it's not. It's less than half of your tuition, your cost of being in college is paid for by the state of Washington, and it's privatized now by international student money.
Yeah, and if you have
same thing happened with prisons.
I think if you have certain drug convictions, you're not even eligible for that money. The American Legislative Exchange Council is a group of, in reference to what you just mentioned, they're a legislative group that are composed of elected officials and private prison companies who have to pay to be a part of this. And this organization, they've kind of come a little bit more into light recently. They influence our politics tremendously. They're actually a big player in the three strikes law, the mandatory minimums. And that law's insane. I mean, like three arbitrary felonies for life in prison is not, it's terrible. you can kind of see in this chart the amount of these elected officials and companies that are receiving money from the private business industry. Are you, any of you familiar with the Arizona Bill 1070? Yeah, there's a lot of media attention to it recently. It's what, you know, it's when you hear about people having to show their papers or whatever at the, near the border, these immigration or citizen checkpoints, which are, have been claimed as unconstitutional, these guys were behind that. And, you know, there's actual direct ties to these. This is a clear money trail from the private prison companies to these things.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes.
So do you think, like, the prison environment, do you think that these corporations, are they publicly traded that own the jails?
So
there's probably both. So that's not a question.
That's
the
a great
deal
point.
Is, like, yeah, these
companies actually trade their stocks on Wall Street based on the amount of prisons they hold in their prison.
So the question mainly is, do you think these companies, so they have their lobbyists in D.C., which is kind of like a bunch of criminals anyway. Hopefully we can change that. But so criminals working for criminals, putting criminals possibly that are in jail. Do you think in prison these guys also have agents that entrap other prisoners to get that free strikes? Like, is
what do you mean?
Like in prison, like there's other prisoners that are kind of agents basically for the corporation.
You know, I'm not really.
Because I've seen movies where, like, you know, there's always like the rats or the guys that are selling drugs in jail, and the prison guards are, you know, part of that whole cabal of getting drugs into the prison. So if you're in prison and you're caught with, you know, a certain drug, that's probably, that might give you a third strike as well and entrap these people forever. Do you suspect anything like that's going on?
I mean, I suspect a lot. Or not.
Do you have any statistics? Like,
yeah, I don't know if it's kind of a hard thing to gather statistics on. I mean, it's really like a, you know, clandestine kind of operation notice, and it sounds illegal. Yes?
I mean, with the whole war on drugs, like, they've been funneling drugs into actual neighborhoods. I would imagine they're doing the same thing in prisons.
Familiar with the freeway Mickey Ross, that whole incident, you know, CIA selling cocaine.
Yeah.
They caught. What people don't understand is the CIA was actually caught selling cocaine in L.A. to this guy named Premier Ricky Ross, who actually, not like single-handedly, but he was a huge influence in the rise of cocaine in the 1980s in L.A. Yes?
It's also worth noting that the war on drugs, when somebody's arrested for a drug, major drug offense, all their property becomes property of the police department that arrested them for auction.
Yeah, all for jobs are a huge incentive to local law enforcement. They actually, it just goes directly back into their pockets. Some of them, you know, depending on if they even report it. This is just a kind of a rundown of an independent kind of analysis of the proposed savings in Arizona. And after, so what these private prison companies do is they only take the easiest to care for prisoners. So they take the minimum and some medium security prisoners. And they don't take the sick, and they don't take the unruly. And they use this to kind of shape kind of a false savings. But when it counted for these things, we found that they save about 3 cents per prisoner in Arizona. And that, you know, I'm assuming this will be per day. Arizona is kind of all time off. Median security prisons actually pay for the taxpayers actually pay $4.60 more per prison. And they do this across the board. That's, you know, there aren't a whole lot of studies out on this yet. So the problem in terms of prisoners is pretty, we hold more prisoners than any other country in the world, both by numbers and by this is vast. I mean, this goes all levels of politics. Campaign
contributions, relationships, and associations. That's immigration.
I apologize, I was kind of trying to throw this together last minute. A little bit disorganized.
Content is here, I swear.
Made me a little dizzy.
Make it clear that I've done my investigations and I understand that there is still a racial disparity in prisons. I'm merely trying to find kind of a unifying principle. And the percentages have shifted over the years. But it still remains that we don't really have rich people, wealthy individuals in prisons. I feel like that's pretty good evidence. I mean, kind of what I had mentioned before about, this whole criminalization, this process of addiction, kind of dehumanizes people to a point. In many ways, it's kind of the intention of it. That way, people don't have to feel when they make these laws, when they change, when they throw people away. Here's a pretty good example of just kind of the difference between, in terms of safety, state-run and private-run institutions in Idaho, with just in 1 year, 42 violent interactions, something made in the assaults, versus 132 in the private institution.
Any other questions?
Yes.
So even though the crime rate, the one chart you showed has the crime rate going down, the actual number of people in prisons has gone up
a
huge amount.
A lot of this kind of goes on the whole tough on crime ideology. This is it's used by politicians as a platform for gaining votes. No politician can really be seen as being soft on crime. Because it costs them votes, it could potentially cost them their office. Yes?
I mean, that's been the thing of being elected anyway. You have to have some sort of issue that you said you should fix, whether it's actually an issue or not. When the war on drugs was, or when they started that, the drug rate had gone down. It was like at a low at the time.
When they started the
yes.
Really?
Yes.
Doesn't work at all?
But they had to use something as a distraction. So it's all smoke and mirrors.
Yeah, I mean, this whole system is, it's not in the interests of society, and that's kind of the main point. I mean, I apologize for my whole presentation thing and my train of thought being a little scattered. I'm trying to get a lot of information here and don't have it all together. Here's a particularly interesting fact. How many of you are familiar with Sesame Street? Sesame Street? Yeah, pretty much everybody. So with 1 in 28 children behind bars, 1 in 28 children with at least one parent behind bars, Sesame Street actually started a special that proves to help kids with understanding parents in prison. And this is, I mean, for me, this is really tells a lot. I mean, really, it signifies the extent.
Actually, I do understand what you're going through. When I was about your age, my dad was incarcerated too.
Like for a while, but there was also the redefinition of crime. which should be considered when viewing something like that with crime rates, because, you know, these weren't always crimes. These are a lot of these sick individuals. They need help. And we've curtailed services, we've reduced funding to the point where these people really have nowhere to go in their desperate situations. And they end up in these prisons, which are, you know, with these mental health issues. They're mixed in with, you know, violent criminals. And this, you know, horrible situation that we've kind of produced for people that we lock up, someone referred to it as kind of like a crime university of sorts. Mm-hmm. People come out of these institutions knowing more about crime than when they went in. And if we follow in these footsteps of China, of Russia, these countries actually have extensive mafia organized crime organization of abilities. And this actually stems from contempt for the law, for not believing, for the law not being good for people. And, you know, I don't believe that law necessarily something, just because something's illegal doesn't necessarily denote that it's immoral. I mean, you know, I personally feel like marijuana is a pretty good one. It's not really hurting anybody. It's not damaging society. But by enacting these laws, we are damaging society. So something that wasn't hurting society to begin with now is, but not because of the act, but because of our approach to it. Yes.
I just wanted to say I have schedules for spring quarter.
Okay.
I
think I'm about to.
A lot of exciting things coming up.
Yes.
So if the practice of contracting out private companies and individuals ceased, then that would be dirty. How is going in some of these other companies that might be?
Sorry, I kind of skipped over that a little bit before the conversation. With that redefinition of crime, what we saw by the numbers, mind you, numbers. They don't really tell the whole story. It's oversimplifying things. By the numbers, there was a huge increase in crime. We started filling our prisons. Closing these mental institutions was bringing people in society. We had a huge influx in prisoners, and it placed a tremendous burden on the system that had been working for 78 years. So there was a lot of talk about this, and they went the way of Sam Adams, that whole idea, which I believe is what deregulation of these public services is really based on, is, you know, the free hand of the hand of the open market, kind of regulating things and acting. It's something of a higher power of sorts. It's a really very idealistic way to do things, but, you know, all conjured up quite a while ago, and I don't really feel like any of that with what we understand now is really that valid. But they, back in around 1979, initiated this, an act to better prisons, which opened the way for private contracting for prison labor. Yeah. And that's kind of how all this started again. So this has been going on about 40 years. On the 40th anniversary of the company CCA, they pulled in roughly $1.7 billion, I believe. And so with the pressure that we're applying now, they're actually exporting this idea. What we've done in terms of crime, we've actually commodified culture and turned crime into entertainment. With police shows, there's so many police and crime shows out there now. And this is really what we do to entertain ourselves now. And this whole, a lot of these ideals and concepts are being exported from the US. And other countries are starting to see the same thing. I know Australia and the United Kingdom are really starting to engage in more of the private prison practices. And while doing my research, I found a lot of the things I was looking for and expecting in the US, I find a lot of far worse abuses over in those countries, who is, at the moment anyway, seems to be less regulation, less oversight.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any further questions? Any comments? Any insight? Yeah.
Do you know of anything being done to say if actually I'm going to introduce the population right now in the US?
There are a lot of things being done to reduce prison populations. I know California has undergone a number of, like, they've been reducing prison populations. So that's why these companies are starting to shift their efforts to these other countries, to immigration, and immigration, you're guilty by being in the country. And they're locking up an unprecedented amount of immigrants that were just never locked up until they were just sent right back home.
So they're not deporting them anymore?
I think they are eventually deporting them, but they're holding them. And they're holding them based on, you know, a lot of laws that have been passed in like the last maybe 5 or 10 years. And I see a lot of this on television these days. And I know Obama's trying to fight for the immigration reform. And I really question the opponents of these measures. And really, like, with the whole, like, polarization of our politics and, you know, what I see as the Republican way of, you know, you're with us or you're against us, are you with us? People, I think a lot of people are afraid to speak up because they don't want to be, you know, ostracized from their groups. Yeah, so I believe that just, kind of just keeping focus on why we're putting people in, why we're incarcerating people, and if these solutions are effective, which by the numbers, they're not effective anymore. This needs to stop. Keeping focus on, you know, like I think what a lot of Norwegian or Finland, Denmark do is they actually take a different approach towards viewing, punishment for a crime, and I think they call it a community-based or restorative rather than punitive. And I believe that's a little bit more along the lines of they do fantastically. They have some of the most effective, lowest recidivism rates, lowest crime rates, and happiness levels in the, you know, in the world. And that restorative process is kind of more based on looking at the crime, looking at the individuals involved, looking at the damage that the crime did to the individual that were involved and society, and looking to restore that. And rather than having these mandatory, these like stern guidelines, things are subjective, and can be things subjective by doing things like this, but basically like turning this into a math equation. And then misses so much. You can't use people.
So they just have a far greater number of judges and things like that that are looking at individual cases, and maybe just put a lot more money in general into the structure that looks at things like more on a case-by-case basis, or
They put a lot more energy into it, but it seems like they get a lot more in returns. Mm-hmm. I mean, the
sure.
maximum sentences over there are 5 and 7 years, and that's tough to become a thing over here. And it, you know, we put people in these situations where they basically have to survive. And they learn, you know, bad habits, and they come out emotionally
scarred.
Yeah.
It's a traumatic experience.
Yeah.
Talking about redefining crime in Florida, they just, the NRA lobbied to make it illegal for healthcare providers to ask about guns in the home or to provide any safety guidance on guns, punishable by 5 years in prison or a $50,000 fine, if they even mention it. So I guess I'm going for the higher intelligence there.
I know in Michigan, they would offset the cost of the prisoner.
It's common practice in a lot of states. There's a lot of maintaining prisoners and people who are in this system pay their own way. And coming from, like when you're in a poverty stricken, or, you know, when you're in this crazy situation, you have people depending on you, you don't really have any way to, you know, in income. I came up with a bunch of different stories, seen a bunch of different stories of people being locked up just for being poor, essentially, and not having means to get out or pay for their ankle bracelet or, you know, probation services or whatever.
Wisconsin parents are assessed child support if a child is put into juvenile justice system. They have to pay the state.
Juvenile justice system is particularly interesting. I have some particular experience in that.
Yeah, the juvenile justice system in this country, 40% is privately run. Huge, vast abuses. I mean, these are juveniles aren't, a lot of them really can't compare themselves. So we're putting these, people who really can't defend themselves in these crazy situations. There's tons of stories of abuse in that whole realm. And in Wisconsin, in a lot of other states, we actually, I'm from Wisconsin, we actually, we charge anybody, we put anybody charged with a crime when you're 17, is automatically an adult. 16, sorry. We actually sentence juveniles to life in prison and death, like no other country in the world. Yeah, thank you all for coming.
Thank you so much.